Hi, everyone. Well, after 2.5 years, the COVID-19 pandemic appears to be ebbing in many parts of the world, and transmission rates will hopefully continue to decline further as vaccine use spreads and we learn more about coronaviruses. So does that mean that this is the right time to begin worrying about the next epidemic? Luckily for us, there are innovators and experts around the world whose job it is to do just that, prepare for the next public health emergency. One of these people is Dr. Richard Hatchett, CEO of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, or CEPI. CEPI is a Norway-based vaccine development fund working against epidemic threats. It was launched in 2017 to support the development of vaccines for a range of deadly diseases, including Ebola, and it's also working to help the world prepare for the next epidemic, whatever that might be. Dr. Hatchett is here to talk to us about how investing in research and development is critical to save human lives, and how CEPI uses a multi-stakeholder approach to developing vaccine predicates for diseases that may not even exist yet. Dr. Hatchett, it's a great pleasure to have you here. Welcome to WIPO.
Thank you, Amy. It's a pleasure to join you, and happy to talk about this.
So, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, that is a very big name and a very big mandate. Please tell us more about that, Richard.
That's why we call it CEPI, usually. We don't spell out the whole name, but each word in the name is important. The coalition aspect, in terms of bringing together partners from across sectors, is a very important part of what we do. We don't think any single sector obviously has the solutions for these kinds of threats. We also need innovations to achieve preparedness for future epidemic and pandemic threats. We have seen through the course of the pandemic validation of new technologies, new rapid response technologies, particularly, I think everybody's familiar with the mRNA vaccine technologies and how well they have performed. We've got a toolkit now that we need to turn to other disease threats beyond coronaviruses if we're going to be prepared for future threats. And I think our most recent experience with monkeypox, which I'm sure we'll talk about a bit, exemplifies some of the continuing challenges as well as the promise of the approach that we're proposing to take.
Now, epidemic preparedness innovations. Can we ever really be prepared for an epidemic? And how does innovation help us to do that?
We can't know in advance what the next emerging threat is going to be, particularly if it's a novel virus like SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID. We couldn't have predicted specifically in advance that virus was going to come. But there were a lot of signals, for example, that coronaviruses were a threat that we needed to worry about. Just in previous decades, we've had the experience with SARS-1, with MERS. So we knew that coronaviruses as a threat were something that we need to worry about. And we had actually taken significant steps to prepare ourselves for a future coronavirus threat. And a lot of work had been done, for example, looking at how to develop vaccines first against SARS and then against MERS to understand the parts of those viruses that you had to target, and even to understand how you could modify what's called the spike protein to make it even more visible to the immune system to produce a more potent immune response. And that investment in basic science and understanding the immunology of how to develop vaccines against coronaviruses served us very, very well when SARS-CoV-2 emerged. In fact, it allowed us to move immediately into vaccine production with the mRNA vaccines. I'm very proud to say CEPI moved quickly early in the response to establish vaccine development contracts. We had been working with a number of partners who were working on MERS vaccines, coronavirus vaccines, and we were able to pivot them. We were also able to partner very early on with Moderna, just 12 days after the viral sequences were released. And the work that we funded with Moderna was actually to produce clinical trial material. That's how quickly we went from identifying the threat to being able to ramp up production so that we could start clinical trials. And that was all due to that prior investment in understanding, you know, the class of threat, the coronavirus threat. So I think there's a lot that I don't think we can ever be perfectly prepared, but there's a lot that we can do in advance to develop tools to, you know, as far as we can take them so that we're prepared for different kinds of threats. And this, again, I mentioned monkeypox earlier. Monkeypox is also a validation of this idea that we can be very prepared, even if we can't predict perfectly what the future threat is. Over the last couple of decades, the U.S. government in particular had invested hundreds of millions of dollars in developing smallpox vaccines because of concerns that smallpox, a disease that doesn't exist anymore, might be used by a terrorist or potentially a state actor as a bioweapon. And the vaccines and the therapeutics that were developed for smallpox, fortunately, have the attribute of being effective against an entire class of virus, against what are called the orthopox viruses. And so the vaccines and therapeutics we have for smallpox work for cowpox, they work for mousepox, they work for horsepox, and importantly, they work for monkeypox. And so when the monkeypox epidemic began to spread globally, we actually have effective vaccines and effective therapeutics already available because of those prior investments, because we know that orthopox viruses as a family present a potential threat to humans. And what CEPI is proposing to do, in hopefully with international partners, not just by ourselves, is to develop vaccine libraries of vaccines that are targeted against what we call prototype pathogens of each viral family. And there are about 25 or 26 of these that we know can cause human disease, so that we are as prepared for any other class of virus as we were for coronaviruses, as we were for the orthopox viruses.
That's so interesting. And, you know, I, as you respond, I hear some elements of broader context in there. And what I would really like to ask you now to speak about is the broader context within which CEPI operates, because you all are very focused on vaccine development and supporting vaccine development. But as you know, when it comes to a global response, for example, to COVID-19, to monkeypox, to MERS and SARS and even Ebola, the response is about much more than what is available to actually prevent or treat the disease. And I know that you've had some real fascinating experience with the broader context when it comes to response to global health threats. I wonder if you could touch on that now.
Sure. Well, that broader context is critically important. I mean, countermeasures, which is the space that CEPI works in, are critical tools as part of a global response. But I think for the world to have a disease detection and response capability that allows us to dramatically take down the risk of future epidemics or pandemics, and I do think epidemic or pandemic infectious disease risk is really one of the constitutive threats that we will face in the 21st century, and partially it's because it's driven by climate change, but it's also driven by demography and human, you know, patterns of using environmental resources. But these types of threats have the potential to be hugely disruptive. I've likened them to, you know, it's like dropping a gigantic stone into a pond, and it creates ripples and waves that slosh around long after the stone sinks out of sight. And so a lot of the economic fallout of the pandemic we're still experiencing in terms of inflation and in terms of economic stress, potentially even spilling over into concerns about food crises. And so these after effects of the pandemic are going to last for a long time. So it is really important that we develop a comprehensive capability to detect and respond. And I think as we at CEPI work on our piece, which is focusing on countermeasure development, countermeasure preparedness, that also has to happen in a context where a society's ability to respond to an emerging crisis, a threat like an epidemic or a pandemic, has to be built on the foundation of capabilities that are in use every day. And so we also have to think about strengthening healthcare systems globally and strengthening the ability to reach vulnerable populations globally if we're going to respond effectively when the next threat emerges.
So it's really interesting that you talk about society's ability to respond, because I feel like the COVID-19 pandemic came just at the same time as I think the world was realizing that climate change is a huge existential threat, not only to humanity, but to all life on this planet. And since then, there's kind of been a convergence of recognition and ideas that global health is essentially inseparable from climate change and environmental degradation. How is CEPI taking that into account in your work?
There's a concept in the emergency response community that in thinking about these zoonotic diseases, diseases that emerge from animals into human populations, and that's where all new threatening viruses essentially emerge from some animal reservoir into a human population. And the concept is called One Health. And the idea is that you have to think of human health in a continuum with animal health, veterinary health, but the health of domesticated animals, livestock, but also the health of wild populations, which is where a lot of these zoonotic diseases circulate. And actually, you know, if you take the most expansive concept of One Health, that also has to include environmental health. So you know, we all exist within one system where you have climate driving migration of species, migration of pathogens, humans interacting with, you know, the animal populations that we coexist with in an environment that is continuing to change. And obviously now with global warming under significant stress in many locations, and that stress in and of itself can produce changes in the microbial populations. The microbes can respond to environmental stress and adapt, and that can include mutating in ways that might increase their risk of popping out into human populations. And so I think as we think about these diseases and as we think about the risk that we face, we really have to have that holistic conception of existing in a changing and dynamic environment.
Dr. Hatchett, I would like to close our interview by first of all wishing CEPI a very happy fifth birthday. I understand that it is CEPI's fifth year in operation, so congratulations on that. And I would love to ask you, what in that time, how have you seen the innovation ecosystem change in the past 5 years? And it's interesting because for half of CEPI's lifespan, the world has been consumed with COVID-19. Which, you know, as you just put it in your last answer, is actually an opportunity for tremendous amounts of learning, even if it's learning the hard way. How do you think the innovation ecosystem has learned and has evolved over the past 5 years?
Well, I think it's been utterly transformed by the pandemic. I mean, we knew there were promising technologies in the years before COVID, and it, in fact, had invested in many of the technologies that have served us well. We had invested with the Oxford Group and in their ChAdOx vaccine approach. We had invested in mRNA. I mean, we were making investments in these, at the time, potentially transformative technologies. They've now demonstrated their value. We have also seen through the pandemic a massive expansion of vaccine production capability. And production capability of diagnostics, home diagnostics, and therapeutics. And we, in addition to the sort of the transformation of the technical landscape, which has been profound, and probably, you know, we compressed a decade's worth of progress into a year or two during the pandemic on the technical side. We've also seen institutional innovations, the creation of COVAX as a global mechanism for procuring and distributing vaccines, the strengthening and deepening of institutional partnerships through what WHO, the so-called Access to COVID-19 Tools or ACT Accelerator, really being a global roundtable of partners and countries working together. And the final area where I think we've seen a hopefully irrevocable transformation, I think, is in an understanding of the importance of global access to these tools. And the painful experience of the inequities in access that emerged between low-income countries and high-income countries in terms of access to vaccines and therapeutics and diagnostics. We can't deny those inequities, but I think we can also, and this will become increasingly clear as the decades pass, you know, the period in which that inequity was most striking was compressed because of our ability to scale up production of tools and our ability to mobilize resources and to be aware of that inequity and to take steps to try to address it. We need to do better. We need to be more prepared in the future, and we need to not let those inequities emerge or endure as long as they did during COVID. But the overarching trajectory is in a positive direction.
Dr. Hatchett, it has been such a pleasure having you here with us today. Thank you for your leadership, thank you for your contributions, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Amy. It's been a pleasure.
This was a captivating conversation with Dr. Richard Hatchett, who is the Chief Executive Officer of CEPI. And as we heard, Dr. Hatchett and CEPI are committed to bring scientific solutions to epidemic threats. I hope you all enjoyed that conversation as much as I did. And please let us know in the comments below what you think of the race to develop the next generation of COVID-19 vaccines. And don't forget to subscribe to the WIPO channel to receive notifications of other great videos showing how innovation and creativity is improving our world. Stay safe and bye for now.